I'd like to introduce Jeff Minhas, the Executive Director of the Alumni Association.
That's the biggest round of applause I've ever had. I love the audience. I love you guys. You got this great energy for tonight. Wow. Okay. So, very excited. We're talking about some really cool stuff tonight. Esports in particular has taken the world by storm, so to speak. And here at UCI, we're on the cutting edge. And I hope after tonight, everyone here will understand why. We've got some fantastic panelists who I'd like to introduce in a moment. But to the university, it is really important to be a pioneer. UCI 50 years ago was just a bunch of rolling hills where we sit right now. And we've done so much that everyone, past and present Anteaters, should be proud of. And esports is one of those ventures, which we've tried something new. The scope of the program is huge. In fact, I'd like you to read all about it if you haven't yet, but the UCI magazine, the current issue, which goes out to all alumni, staff and faculty, it's all about esports. So we have copies out at front registration. If you don't have one, please pick one up. So thanks again, Monica. I'm the executive director here at the Alumni Association, and we like to bring alumni back to campus, but we like to connect alumni to each other, alumni to students, allow you to build relationships with each other for all kinds of reasons. But alumni have a lot of business experience and wisdom and stories to tell. And we've got some great alumni here tonight. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our esteemed panelists one by one so that they can all get the same generous applause that you gave me, because that felt really good. So I'd like to start with our moderator, who's a relatively new member of the Anteater family, but that would be Dean Marios Papaeftimiou. And Dean Marios, please come on up. Dean Marios joined UCI at the start of 2017 as the new dean of the Donald Brenn School of Information and Computer Sciences. Prior to coming to UCI, he was chair of computer science and engineering at the University of Michigan, overseeing one of the fastest growing and most innovative academic programs in computing across the nation. Prior to that, he was on the faculty at Yale. Dean Marios' research interests are in architectures and design methodologies for energy efficient and high performance computers. He studied at the National Technical University of Athens and Caltech, and received his master's and PhD at MIT. So thank you, Dean Marios, for moderating the panel tonight. I'd like to now introduce distinguished alumnus, Johnny Ho. Johnny Ho's class of, come on up. Class of 2006. And he might share this with you, but all of you take some notes from this gentleman, because he started the business for which he's founder and CEO, NZXT, when he was a junior here at UCI. And he has donated gear for the esports arena and supported student scholarships as part of the esports program. NZXT is an LA-based leading manufacturer of hardware and software solutions for the PC gaming industry. So welcome, Johnny. Thank you for being here. Next up, we have Kieran Foley. Kieran, come on up. Kieran is class of 96 and, making us all feel inferior, also started a company when he was here at UCI studying. He's the co-founder and CEO now of Immersive Entertainment Incorporated, a developer and publisher of virtual reality entertainment software. Welcome, Kieran. Kathy Chang. You might know Kathy. Any of you gamers out there might know Kathy. She's class of 2016, but she serves as the arena coordinator for the UCI esports program. Raise your hand if you've been to the esports arena on campus. All right, well, if you haven't been there, go there later this week and you'll say hi to Kathy. She, when she was a student, she co-founded the Association of Gamers at UCI, which became one of the largest gaming clubs in the world, and really helped to pioneer what became the esports program. So welcome, Kathy. And last but most certainly not least, we have Aiden Moon, AKA Zyrene. Come on up, Aiden. Aiden from the class of 2014 is a professional esports commentator. And he's been commentating for over 3 years of professional play as a shoutcaster for Riot Games. Welcome, Aiden. And this is your distinguished panel. Now, I'm going to hand over the duties to Dean Marios to moderate the panel. And then later on, in about 45 minutes or so, we'll open it up to Q&A from the audience. So, Dean Marios, please take it away.
Thank you, Jeff. It's great to be here. It almost felt like we were at the game, right? You know there's a game. It's five of us, and it almost felt like we were getting into the court. Almost. Okay. By the way, I know you have Twitter feeds and all these things going on, but I have my own phone too, and I will provide the obligatory halftime update about the game, so don't be surprised. Let me start with some questions that I have about our panelists here. What sparked your interest in what you do? I know that you all came out of ICS in one way or another, but there was no computer, game, science major when many of you graduated. So how did you get into that space?
Okay, I guess I'll take that question. I actually majored in computer engineering, and you know, I think we played a lot of games, so that's kind of how we got into gaming. I've been playing games since I was kind of eight. So right around the time I was a junior at school, there's this company, Alienware. I don't know if you guys heard. They're really big at the time, and I couldn't afford one of those. They were like about $3,000 at the time. So you know, I was like, you know, I've always liked design. I like hardware. So what if I went out and designed something that kind of looked like Alienware, but offered it for like normal prices, right? So went ahead and did that in my junior year and shipped our first product kind of senior year, and that's kind of the beginning of the story. I've been doing that ever since. So, but it's, you know, I'm in gaming mostly because I'm just a gamer and I've been playing all my life, so, yeah.
Yeah, I guess I'll go next, if this is gonna work. Okay, so I've been gaming kind of my entire life as well. So I kind of wanted to do something in gaming just growing up, but there wasn't really a huge resource out there for how to get into the gaming industry. So I had no idea that I could even go into the gaming industry when I was growing up. So I kind of just thought about computer science. That's kind of related. So I came to UCI because I noticed that there was a new major released called computer game science. So I was actually the first year, kind of young, I guess, because I just graduated, but it is very new. And now you can actually study something that is completely related to games and game development and just game design, all different aspects of it, producing, whatever you're interested in. So I was really lucky to have that available to me. And after coming here, I thought I would be a programmer and I thought I would program games my whole life, but I discovered that I really liked a bunch of other things, which was, in my case, event running and kind of doing things with the community. So I started a club, and I started running events, and I started doing things with other students and just creating awesome experiences. And I decided that I wanted to pursue this despite what my major was. So I didn't kind of stick to what my major was. I haven't probably used any of the knowledge that I've learned through my classes yet. But I think it's really awesome that I was introduced to it through the major and continue doing it because I just love what I do.
In terms of... it's like really hard to answer this question because it's what got you into gaming. It's what, you know, why do we game and why do I game and why I started that. And I don't want to give you guys my entire life story because gaming is actually my life at this point. And it starts like when I'm really young, and it's usually associated with an injury or pain. I had broken my femur in half when I was 10, and I actually got Pokemon Red, and that's the first game that I ever had. And it was associated with me for a release from pain, a release from being in that room with all these walls around me that, you know, it sucked. It's 6 months in traction with your leg up and you can't go anywhere. You can't be around your friends or anything like that. So gaming allowed me to at least have something else to do. And then it grew from there because then it became competitive. Then it became something I could do socially with other people. And that's why I game. That's why I'm actually into it so much, because so many people have the story of being picked last in kickball or second to last in kickball, right? It's the same story for me as well. So I want to further gaming to a point where the people who don't have that particular physical skill can also be popular in a different way and have that mental skill, can play the game, can go to the esports arena, can join a professional team and still have something to offer that gives them, you know, popularity, something that gives them a little bit more of a purpose in life and that they feel like they have value as individuals.
Back just after the dinosaurs were wiped out by an asteroid, there was a company called Atari, and they produced a very very popular box called the Atari 2600 that a child who had very little social life and enjoyed programming at age six you know, would find fascinating. So I got hooked on video games playing that console day in and day out, learned how to program when I was six. But after that point, became a musician and an artist, got a computer science degree from UCI. I've not always been a gamer in the strictest sense. I mean, I've always played first-person shooters, things like that, just to blow off steam. But the way I found myself in VR is rather interesting. A gentleman came from Belgium who was from the gaming industry, wanted to put together a company. And my background, since graduating, was really forming companies and building companies. And he reached out to myself and my partner and said, you know what, I got an idea for a VR company. That's kind of how we got started, through LinkedIn. Thank you very much. So.
Wow. I have a few tough questions for you guys. By the way, 16-9, 11 minutes to go in the first half. You have to keep your eye on that. So what was your favorite experience at UCI?
Escape?
Escape.
Can I say that?
Absolutely.
Graduation. No, it was an interesting experience for me. It was tough. It was tough when I went through it, and I think it hasn't really changed much. I mean, a lot of students find it difficult because I was balancing, especially in the last sort of half of my career at UCI, I was balancing starting a company. So that was actually an awesome experience. I mean, it was horrifying and very rewarding all at the same time, because, you know, as little sleep as you get as an ICS major, you get even less if you're doing that and starting a company. But it was very rewarding in many, many different ways. So it
can get worse, is what you're saying, right?
It got worse a couple years after I graduated. I kept having dreams that I hadn't graduated yet, but that soon faded.
I still get those, by the way.
So just to add on to that, I was also on the five-year track, and computer engineering was very, very tough for me. I was also doing flights between here and China, like right before midterms, trying to study for them. And the favorite thing about UC Irvine is actually I felt the school gave me an opportunity to pursue my career while trying to graduate. So I was on academic probation probably the last, I want to say, two quarters. I think after two quarters you get kicked out, so I got like one extra quarter.
So I asked for a good experience, not a bad one.
You guys said it was okay to share. I was able to get that extra quarter. I graduated, and I was able to launch basically my career out of the school. So I'm kind of forever indebted to the school for that. Yeah.
So. I don't know if it's because I was like a middle child or something, but I always wanted to please everybody. I always wanted to make everybody happy. So I would appeal to what people thought I should do. And I had a positive psychology teacher that kind of convinced me to not go into psychology anymore. Not because I was bad at it or anything, but because I would be happier doing something else. Because I would be much happier in the gaming industry, in esports. And having that conversation with him really enlightened me and made me feel like I had permission to be myself, permission to go do what I wanted to do.
I've been sitting here this whole time trying to think of my favorite experience, but honestly, UCI was just really good to me. I didn't have a day where I felt like I hated this place. Like, I honestly loved being here, and it kind of feels like I haven't graduated yet, because right after graduating, I was looking for jobs, and the UCI esports program kind of started, so I came right back, and I'm still on campus, still kind of look like an undergrad, so I kind of, you know, I'm still making awesome UCI experiences, honestly, and if I had to choose one, it would probably be during our first large event. It was a really large scale event that we were really ambitious to tackle, and it was a viewing party for the League of Legends World Championships. And this was back in, I believe, 2013. And we decided we wanted to rent out the hangar at the OC Fair and Event Center, which can fill up to about like 2,000 attendees. And before this, our largest event was maybe 500 to 800 people. So it was honestly a huge challenge. And just having that all come together and people message me afterwards and say, dude, that was awesome. Now I want to do my own thing and I want to work on events and things like that. That was just, I think, the best experience I had was just getting that feeling of being appreciated and that you were doing something that people loved.
Actually, I'll jump off of that just briefly. A memory comes back to me now through the pain, the fog. But it was actually really, really positive. It was actually how I started my first company. So I was getting bored just doing programming and I hadn't decided to do a company. But I did want to mix one of my passions, which was music. So we got a couple of other artists who did electronic music. We decided we wanted to put on a concert. So we rent a building over here. But of course, UCI came back and said, OK, it has to be educational. It can't just be a concert. So we go to Yamaha and Kurzweil, and we ask them for money and give them a little business plan. They give us some money. They come out and demo their latest technology for the latest Pink Floyd concert and a couple of others. And we ended up doing a successful concert for like 75 people sold out in that building. And that was really the beginning of something that taught me that, hey, you can go out to companies, raise money, start your own little venture, and do something a little different. And UCI was instrumental in that, to be honest. I mean, the company was started out of there, so that was a very unique experience.
So how's your typical day? I mean, you're not students anymore. Is there life after UCI?
Is there a typical day? Anybody else? Yeah.
Was the question, is there life after UCI?
Nope.
Yeah.
I'm still here.
It's asking a little
well, I'm
much.
Back. how is that? Well, since founding the company in 2003, we're now global. We sell to over 50 countries around the world. We've got 70 employees. Company's growing still really fast. Esports is driving a lot of that. So go esports, you know. So I'm doing what I love. So you know. I mean, life is very good.
So what do you still pull all-nighters and stuff like that? You know, where do you show up for work? 11 a.m. or something?
Well, we just had a four-month-old baby, so it's a little bit tough.
Wow.
Now.
No sleep for you.
But I'm still finding gaming time. You know, I do this thing where before I get on the plane, it's about a 14-hour flight going to Asia, so I pack all the single-player games I can onto my razor blade, and then like. I get on a plane and I go like straight six, seven hours and I pass out and then and I sleep, right? You get sleep for less than 8 hours and you're ready to go in the morning. So it's actually a pretty good way to get past
jet lag. How's your accuracy while you're doing this with a baby?
Yeah.
So the secret is long flights, right?
Yeah. So gaming on the long flights, it's a perfect solution there.
Anyone else?
In terms of like what my typical day is or?
Yeah.
So I wake up at 9, I go into the office by 10, esports morning. Then I do story meetings, I look at the news, I talk to teams, I talk to players, I try to understand what they're working on and what they're trying to do in the future, set up story points for the team, talk to the rest of my team and my co-commentators, do practice casts, review your casts from the previous week, and then then you have lunch, then you keep doing that for the rest of the day, then you play a whole bunch, you build a team, and we focus on synergy. Like, that's actually a really big thing at my company is one-on-ones, and it's not one-on-one like, hey, let's talk about what you did. It's like, hey, what'd you do for the weekend, you know? What'd you do on Monday? And you guys just kind of shoot the shit, and you try to build teamwork because if you build a good team internally, you're going to have people who have your back, and you're going to feel better in that environment, and you're going to feel safe. So a lot of my day is dedicated to one-on-one time, with my boss, with my coworkers, even people who are cross-discipline who I will never work with in any way, shape, or form because everybody's trying to grow. Then I stay at the office until 7 because LA traffic sucks and I don't want to go home until 7 or 8. And if I go home, I'm probably just going to be on my computer anyway. So I'll stay at the office. I'll watch a whole bunch of VODs. I'll watch cross-region. So it's a lot of consuming the content of my video game, but also talking to everybody in the office and getting their opinions and formulating stories.
Did your experience here at UCI prepare you for all this teamwork aspect of what you do?
When I was here at UCI, yeah, I definitely think so. I think that it wasn't so much my classes or my courses. It was the extracurricular stuff that was offered. When I joined the League of Legends club at UCI, when it had pretty much just been formulated, and they like throw you into a team of five, and you may not like the other four people, but you got to work with them, and you know the drive to win pushes you, and you get everybody together. These types of things are what help you build synergy with people in the future. It's those group projects that you hate in class where there's one guy who's not doing their part. It's like, how do you get them to do their part? You don't have to do it for them exactly, but like, how do you handle those situations? Because conflict is an inevitability, but it's how you handle the conflict.
I think in terms of typical day, there's no typical day. There were different stages to my career, if you can call it that. I've helped start 8 different companies since graduating. And in the beginning of my career, when I was in my 20s, it was go, go, go all the time, right? But you learn, or at least I learned, thankfully, over time, that activity doesn't equal results. And so I was very busy. I didn't have enough time for anything, and it was just constant. Still haven't really taken many vacations, but I do find time to take time off. So today, as an example, I drove down Ortega Highway with a good friend of mine, and we both kind of raced legally. And we had lunch down at the end over Lake Elsinore, and I came back, and that was the large part of my day. And I told the team, I'm gone, because we had won an award last night from Tech Coast Angels, being one of the most promising companies that they've funded. So it's important to take some time off. You're always thinking about what you're doing. I think especially ICS majors, engineers, people who create things. And so it's important to get away from it a little bit to allow your brain to kind of mull it over. So I do leave that time. Other than that, in terms of running the company, a lot of phone calls, a lot of video conferences. Try to avoid driving places when I can, because it's just a waste of time generally. But when we are in person, together, we make it productive and fun. I mean, that's, but no typical day.
I have a tough one again. Can you tell us something about a failure that you experienced in life? How you recovered
from
it?
Yeah? Oh my God.
Let me get that.
I'm telling you, I have some tough questions here.
In alphabetical order? Or?
I'm trying to think of which one. So,
yeah.
We shipped so many bad products. the thing I will say is, and people say this all the time, but a failure really is okay. It's really the act of getting up and then figuring out kind of what went wrong, and then kind of just like changing the path. Course correcting, and you may be wrong again, and then you just course correct again. But it's really that act of getting up. You know, it's like this grit, right? Like, and I think it helps when you're mission driven. If you're driven around a objective that's more than just I want to make a lot of money, I want to blah 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 do this, because then it's there's things that's driving you beyond those things. And so failure is just it's part of life. I tell my team all the time, please actually go and fail and learn, because it's normal, right? And if you're not failing, you're probably just getting lucky, you know, honestly, right? So yeah, I think failure. I there's so many examples I can't even think of them. I mean, I failed at managing people, I failed at restructuring the company, I failed at launching the wrong products, right? But you know, as long as you are smart about it, you understand the risk you're taking, you plan ahead of time, and you kind of have a controlled way of taking risks and failing, then everything's going to be fine. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. Can I say? Yeah. Yourself? No? I'm going to put you on the spot. I had a big disappointment, which was kind of, I mean, I've had lots of failures along the way as well, but this one sticks in my mind because it taught me a lot. It humbled me. I had quite a bit of success with the company that I ran initially outside of UCI for about 10 years. And during that time, we brought on an individual and decided to start a company that wasn't just service-oriented. We were going to do kind of a social company to bring together a huge industry. And we had some success with beginning to put that together. We hired a huge law firm. We had the business plan built. We spent literally almost 2 years putting it together. So you can imagine working 2 years on something. And then that was also one of my first fundraising experiences. So I was flying off to Boston to meet with people in suits. I had no idea what I was doing. No idea. But nevertheless, over the course of 10 months, I was able to raise a $6 million commitment to fund the company. And so we got the call, and you can imagine what that feels like. It's fantastic. but also imagine for a moment that 2 weeks later, the entire market blows up. That was the dot-com crash. So 2 weeks after getting that great news, everything fell apart, and 2 years of our lives just went down the drain. But not really. Because you pick up and you learn. I mean, I think we all cried for like 48 hours after that. But then you pick yourself up and you figure out what you're gonna do next. And great things came out of that eventually. But that was tough. That was tough. And even to this day, it's like a war story. You know, the group that put that together still remembers fondly. But it also built great friendships as well. It's one of the toughest things we did.
Anyone else wants to take a crack at this?
There's just, it pretty much every day is a failure for me.
Hello, my name is Kieran.
Like, and I think that's going to be something that resonates up here as well, because every day, you're never going to get it right. Every day is full of failures. I'll be on air and I'll say something incorrect. I'll say the wrong team. I'll say the wrong score. I'll phrase something incorrectly. I'll end my sentence as if I'm going to continue it right afterward. And then it just ends up feeling really bad. So there's just, your days are chock full of failures. And over time, you learn to pick yourself up a whole bunch and make sure that you learn from them. And I think that's like the big thing when you realize failing is okay. You don't need to hide your failures. You need to figure out how to move forward with them and continue. Because failures are honestly the biggest way that I learn. And they don't necessarily have to be my failures as well. That's why I love reading things like memoirs and a lot of books, because other people's failures are things that you can learn from as well. And I want to say, like, these two guys, you guys are monsters, because you know, like, we're up here and we're like coming straight out of UCI. We're both still relatively young. I like to think I'm young still. and we have so much that we haven't done yet, but you guys are chock full of knowledge. You guys have started companies, multiple companies, and you've had to do things that I will probably never have to do in my life. It's like, maybe fire people, right? And maybe like make really hard decisions.
Well, for the record, I prefer other people's failures.
Yeah, that's true, that's true. So I think there's a lot to be learned here, and I think that these two guys on the ends are very, very important to listen to, too. Not that Kathy isn't important.
Oh, boy.
Another failure, right?
Like, the main reason why I haven't really spoken up is for kind of what you said, is that I think the more you have experiences, the more failures you have. So obviously, you two have a lot more experiences than we do, so I have a lot more things to share. And I know I kind of disagree that every project you do, there's going to be failures here and there. For me, like, I fail at a bunch of events, right? Some events just never happen, or you have to come up with $8,000 short all of a sudden when you realize that your funding isn't coming through, or you didn't plan an event in as far enough in advance. So all these little failures are things that I'm very, very familiar with, but I have a really hard time pinpointing like one that has really made a big difference in my life. You kind of just learn from it and move on.
If there's something practical I could offer, it's film yourself. If you're going to be doing stuff that are projects, whatever, you take a little documentary. You guys have the phones. Film yourself at your most vulnerable, at pivotal points. Keep it private if you want to. It doesn't matter, but you're going to learn a lot from that. We actually did 15 or 16 hours of film. Man, I'm dating myself. Digital, back in the first business. And there's some really embarrassing footage in there that nobody will ever see. But it was super useful. Why? Because you go back and you start looking at habits that you have, and you start seeing yourself from a different angle, and you go, you know what, not only did I make that mistake, but I'm repeating it now, and let me learn from that. So I'd say document, document, document. That'll help you in your life throughout, because it's so easy to do.
What's your favorite book?
Princess Bride.
The Little Prince.
There's a book. The most recent book in my mind, I guess, the Hard Things by Ben Horowitz. He's a pretty famous VC, but he basically talks about the failures of having only like a couple weeks left of cash with the company and basically pivoting the company completely to something else. And when you hear those stories, like really, my failures are nothing. So it makes me feel pretty good, you know. And like I said, it's just like everything's actually going to be okay in the end, yeah.
Yeah, if I had to choose one, I guess it's a series. So the first book is called The Machine of Death, and the second one is called This Is How You Die. And it's in this universe where there's like this machine that can tell you exactly how you're going to die, but it can be very ironic in what it says. So if it says old age, it could be that you die, you know, of old age, or you could be run over by an old person at some, like, you know, crossing the street. So it's kind of a story that has it's a short story and like a bunch of short stories. And they kind of explore different aspects of what the universe will be like in a universe in which this machine exists. So it could be relationships might be torn apart, or how do hospitals deal with these predictions and kind of the way they operate. So there's like a billion different little mini universes. And I think it's really cool because I guess it's a little morbid, and I like morbid things a little bit, but it's also very fun to read just to think of like all the creative ways that people have thought of how the world is going to change that way.
What do you do for fun? Outside work, which is fun, right?
Play a different video game. honestly, like, I never thought I'd be that guy, but like going to the gym is actually a lot of fun for me because you get to feel like you're making progress even in face of all the failures. You're seeing the numbers go up over time. You're actually feeling like if I just spent that hour there today, then it's a successful day to me because I'm taking steps forward no matter what. So I can go into the office afterwards, fail my butt off, and I'll actually have a lot of fun. So I think that, I'll play like other video games too, and that's still like part of my job. So maybe I live a little bit of an unhealthy life and is not like the perfect example here because I'm still learning how to do this where you balance your work life and your personal life because I'm just, it's video games all the time. It's thinking about video games because I'm in the mindset of this is a job that a lot of people want, that a lot of people can already do very well, and I need to be elite. I need to be the best. I need to be the person who's on those casts when there's only three people who get to do the world finals. I need to be better than the people who have the same expertise as me. So I know how much they stay awake. I know how much they play. I need to do more. I need to work smarter. I need to work harder. And they already have years of experience up over me. So I'm in the mode where I'm trying to make this something that I can do my entire life. And I love it. So honestly, what I do for fun is I do my job.
Yeah, and it sounds cliche, but I love what I do every day. I mean, I really do. But if we're looking for non-work stuff, exercise, having really long philosophical discussions sometimes that deteriorate with friends over a beer or three. Exercise, reading, taking time off when nobody else can. That's also a lot of fun. You know, when the world's kind of empty and everybody else is at work and you just go, no, today's a non-work day. I'm going to do nothing. One of the best things I did was reset once last year, and I'm going to do it again this year, and that is took off on a car trip. I had no idea where I was going to go. I left everybody behind. That includes my kids. Just completely. I turned off the phone. Nobody knew where I was. I didn't know where I was going. And it was fantastic. I recommend it to everybody.
It's like the 90s, right? That's the way it used to be.
Yeah, it's great.
These things were.
It's awesome.
Was your wife okay with that?
She was fine. I said, I'll see you in a few days. Bye.
Yeah, I'm sitting here looking at
my
wife.
She was like, probably going. She was going, yeah. How is it? Awesome. I think she was disappointed when I came back, but you know.
Yeah, free time, I play games. I guess that's expected. I work in the esports arena, so games are all around me all day. There's something I do that's kind of weird, I guess. I don't know if a lot of people do this, but I also type competitively. So I found out recently that I'm one of the fastest typers in the world, and that kind of fed my competitive spirit because I've never really been at the top of any of the video games I play. But just that typing speed, I was like, hey, this is something I'm actually pretty good at, so I'm just going to waste a bunch of time hurting my wrists. But it's a lot of fun. I just spend maybe like an hour or two every day or more.
Wow.
Just kind of like trying all these different quotes and seeing if I can set records. And it's pretty fun. My peak speed right now is 276 words per minute, but that's for very short periods of time. But I average around 170, 180.
Wow.
Yeah. It's fun.
So you win every argument when you're texting. You win every argument when you're texting, huh?
It helps, yeah.
Like, shit.
If someone's bringing up one point and you're bringing up three, it
right.
Kinda you just overload them with information. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Well, I mean, reading games, I mean, I don't get a lot of time to play games now, so I really, really cherish the time I have with games, so it's definitely games. It's like, yeah, I mean, played too much games when I was in school and really didn't appreciate the time I had. Now it's like 2 hours. Yes, you know.
So if you were to go back and do this all over again, what would you do different?
I would go to class. I attended some classes, especially the ones that are really important, but I obviously didn't go to class as much as I should have since I did stay an extra quarter. So I honestly think that it would have been a lot easier for me and I would have learned a lot more if I went to more of my classes. And I don't know, I keep telling people, like my student staff that come in and they're like, yeah, I have class right now, but I'm just gonna sit here and eat lunch or hang out. And I'm like, no, you have to go to class and take notes and it's really important. But I feel like kind of like a hypocrite every time I say it. But I think it's very valuable and you know, sometimes I wish I could get all that money back that I put into my major and kind of like relearn it. There was actually a class I took in senior year that was a retake because I got an F on it the previous quarter. And I actually decided to retake the class even though I didn't have to because I realized that at the end of the quarter, I had no idea what was being taught. And it was actually something I was kind of interested in. So I went back and I learned the class and went to all of my lectures. And for the first time, I was actually getting, you know, A's and B's on my midterms and my finals. And that felt really nice. And now I have that skill set that I wouldn't have had if I just gave it up.
I would probably go to class a little bit more. I would say, you know, I wish I had seen earlier the impact of engineering and computer science and how it, and its applications on in today's world, especially right with on-demand services like apps and, you know, it's basically tech is what software is eating the world, as the Silicon Valley would say. And every time I've got an idea that's kind of software, I have to go over to my engineering manager or my director of engineering, because I don't code anymore, and I honestly didn't code that much coming out of school. And I just really wish I had just paid a little bit more attention and took it and went into engineering understanding kind of like the implications for how it's applied. You know, for me, I was like, oh, it's coding, you know. But if I was actually able, now that I can see kind of the applications of it, I mean, I would pay way more attention in class.
I probably would have started doing what I was doing earlier, because I kind of got in a little bit after it had started, about maybe 2-3 years after it had been, you know, on the climb. And so, you know, going to class is also something that I would want to do a little bit more of, and actually like be there on time and be there for the full duration and all of that. But in like reality, I think I honestly probably would have just gone into my craft a little bit earlier. It's kind of like being an actor, being in talent, where they don't care if you have your master's. They just care if you can do a damn good job. They care if you're able to deliver. They care if you're able to do the role. So if I was doing it earlier, if I had started my YouTube earlier, if I had actually started commentating earlier, then I would be in a better spot than I am now, right? So like, it's kind of like if I had a time machine, go back, practice a little bit more, and then fast forward, and I'd be right here with more years of experience. I'd be wiser, and I'd be better at my craft, because I absolutely love it, and I wouldn't want to be doing anything else.
So when you start businesses and you work with a lot of different people, in my first business, I had 400 clients over a 10-year period. So you imagine the number of people that you interact with. And even since then, meeting a lot of founders, you tend to see a lot of different personalities. And one of the lessons that I've taken away from that is learning how to end relationships much faster and much more decisively. That doesn't mean burning bridges, but it means leaving people who don't do you any good behind quickly. There are people out there who just suck your time and energy. They'll help you fail. They'll create situations that are impossible through sometimes no fault of their own, and other times through fault of their own. But learning that lesson is a tough one. So I'd say trust your gut and jettison failing relationships very quickly in business or in collaborations when starting a company or doing projects. Run. Your gut's usually right. And yes, I am thinking of particular people, but I won't name them here.
So was there ever fear in your life?
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah. You were always confident, yeah.
Speaking as an entrepreneur and having had the experience, no, there's some very dark moments. I think actually it's something that entrepreneurs don't talk about a lot. It's starting to be, you know, looked at more. You tend to be in isolation a lot of the time, you know. Friends and family are the first ones that will tell you discreetly, you know, maybe you should go get a job, maybe you should go do that. Are you sure? They care about you, right? But you're not getting the type of support, you're not getting unfettered support. You know, a lot of people early in a career or early in a project or whatever, they're not the ones who are going to tell you you're going to make it. So you kind of feel very isolated and alone. And that can lead to depression. It can lead to very difficult times. And of course, there are failures. And there's some big failures. I mean, the one that I talked about before, when you think your whole career is over and you've been thinking about something for 2 years and working on it, it just explodes in front of you. And you're thinking, okay, I've been doing a non-job. Can I get a job? You know, how do I recover from this? Those are really dark moments. So yeah, absolutely. And there's great fear in that. Get sleep, get exercise, get away from it for a little bit, regain perspective, and then get back on the horse in some way. It's never that bad, but it is really bad when you're in it. Yeah, absolutely. Lots of fear.
Yeah, no, there's big time fear. I'm pretty sure everybody's going to echo that here too, because, and it's going to be unique as well, because yeah. I'm somebody who suffers from like MDD, right? I have major depressive disorder. I've actually attempted suicide twice in my life because I've been so upset and I've been so scared of what comes next, right? When I was younger, it was always like, do I have worth? Do I have value? Did that failure was so much? Do I actually like? Can I go on living? Right? It's like very dramatic, but those things will eat away at you. And the fear of when I was at UCI, I actually didn't graduate. I didn't finish. I stopped 2 quarters before I graduated, and I went and I started my YouTube channel and I continued my YouTube channel. Then I applied to Riot Games and then they hired me. So I actually left because I was unhappy here, but I was so scared about what came next, about what was the next step for me. Because if I fail that, do I now go back to what I was dreading doing in the future? Do I go back to what I really was like, okay, is this how I want to spend the rest of my life? Because I love video games and I love playing in my free time, but nobody really made a career out of it just yet in terms of esports commentating. So it was new ground that I didn't really have any idols to look up to. I had regular sports commentating, but then I didn't really have anybody in esports. So yeah, there's always fear there when you're blazing a new trail. You don't really have the same types of heroes, and it's very hard to be what you can't see and what you have examples for. So there's always fear in this type of job, especially when you're trailblazing.
Yana, I guess on a similar note, you can't know how many people are going to show up at an event while you're planning it. So you can't say, oh, there's going to be 100 people guaranteed, and they're going to all pay like $10 to come in, so I have that revenue to spend. And oftentimes, you're spending money before you even get it. So in a way, you have to find ways to just kind of take risks and hope that it works out for you. So there's a lot of fear in that. There's a lot of fear in making the right decisions, I guess, career-wise. I think that's a common fear for anyone that graduates. You're kind of thinking, do I go to graduate school or do I try finding a job? And I didn't really see myself going into event planning as a job, so I had actually no idea what I was going to do when I graduated. I was like, I could do this nonprofit club thing while like not even a student. Like, that could be the thing I do, but there's no revenue in that. Something I've learned a lot about esports is you kind of have to fake it till you make it. You do a lot of free labor before you actually start getting paid for it. So that's something that was really scary for me, because I was like, eventually, all the money I've saved up from part-time jobs and internships is going to run out, and I'm just going to not be able to do anything. So there was one night where it was particularly depressed, I guess, and I was trying to figure out, should I go back and try doing programming again and, you know, build up my portfolio with a bunch of code and projects and try applying to like software engineering jobs, because I knew that I could do it in terms of like the knowledge that I had if I put the effort into building that portfolio. But compared to all my peers that were graduating who had been doing this for the past 4 or 5 years, they had a bunch of experience that they could actually go to the job market and say, hey, I can start working today and I will be good at this, while I was spending like 90% of my projects on Stack Overflow trying to figure out how to parse a string correctly. So it took me a while to realize that, hey, I kind of already went down a path that I should just focus on. And I decided that whether that's working in gaming communities or in the esports industry, I've kind of put myself on that path starting 4 or 5 years before I graduated. And so I stuck with it. And thankfully, UCI Esports was successful, and I was able to apply for this job and continue doing what I love instead of kind of going back and trying to put myself on a path in which I was many years behind my peers.
There's definitely a lot of fear. Early on in my career, it was just the fear of not being able to survive. we bootstrapped the business. We didn't take in outside funding. So I think I was making 50 cents per product we sold. So I think I was making less than a full-time job, making minimum wage. So fear of not having a career, fear of like, now I've been doing this for 13 years. What happens if I don't have this anymore? This is all I know, right? The fear of bringing a senior exec, right? Someone who's coming from really large corporation, coming to a startup culture, what that impact is on the current team. And the fear of launching new products, what the media is gonna say tomorrow when they review the product, and are they gonna bash it or whatever, you know? And these are things that keep you up at night, you know, and you get nightmares sometimes. But, you know, I think, there's fear everywhere, but, you know, you learn to cope with it, yeah.
We're getting close to the Q&A, but I have one final question. We talked about risks, we talked about challenges, but obviously you're doing very, very well, to say the least. Share with us a moment where you felt, I nailed it, a great moment.
So So recently, there's been a lot of positive reinforcement when it comes to funding. It's something, as a CEO of a company, I've had to do a lot of in this latest adventure with this VR company. And so after each one of those fundings, you get that rush. And it's fantastic because it's a lot of work. I often describe funding as being the closest thing to politics that I can imagine. You're corralling cats, you're making individual relationships, you're building trusted relationships. It's not just going in with your hand out, you have to add value. You have to communicate in a way that other people oftentimes cannot. You have to simplify complex issues. And then you have to get along with difficult personalities. And you have to do that on a roadshow constantly to groups that maybe have rejected you before, and now you're coming back for a second time, and this time, you know, you're nailing it. And those times when, every time actually, when a team, in this case, Tech Coast Angels, Pasadena Angels in our case, Wharton Angels, comes back and say, we're gonna fund you. I mean, that's just an awesome feeling that the team shares. Individually, it is the culmination of a lot of work, and then there's fear right after that. So then you're like, okay, now I'm taking other people's money, I gotta deliver. We have to deliver. It's never I, right? It's a team thing. So anyway, but that, it's tremendously satisfying, and it's a great skill set to develop. There's a lot in it. So yeah, that's very rewarding.
So last year at the Midseason Invitational, which is our second biggest tournament that we throw, I was not involved in the Midseason Invitational. I was involved in it my first year, or I guess the year after my first year, and then last year I was not involved in it. And so I had a conversation with my boss, like, you know, did I take a step back? What happened? And he's like, okay, well, we're cutting down the size of it to this many commentators. And I didn't make the cut. And then this year, I learned that I will be attending the Midseason Invitational, which means I'm now top 8 in the world for my role. Considered, and this is the best part, too, is it's a subjective craft. Nobody can actually measure your ability as a commentator. It's, are you appealing to the types of things like narrative, storytelling, flow? Do the fans like you? Do you have this type of delivery on games? Are you able to give those moments their due diligence and make people actually really remember those things? So I learned that very recently. So that was one of those ones where I went, like, I made it. Like, that's such a good feeling, because I got so angry with myself, because I was like, you want to be the best. And that's the big motivator is, you know, you're working with a team, but you still want to be the best, right? It's like you were saying, it's always we, but it's at the end of the day, it's always like the team needs to get up there, but still I need to also be really good as well. It's kind of a strange like thing where you're constantly have this cognitive dissonance of, you know, be a team player, but really I still need to be on those casts, but I need to be happy for these guys and support them if they make them over me, right? Mm-hmm. So it's constantly a push and pull in those things. But that was one of those moments like this year, actually, like a week ago, that I was really, really happy about. Yeah, not announced. Do not talk about that.
Yeah, I was wondering. So I guess mine is pretty simple. It was when a couple weeks after I started my job here at UCI Esports in the arena, and I was sitting there, and I was just watching people play games all around me, and I was just chilling and hanging out with people, talking about games, having fun, you know, giving mentorship to some of the students that look up to me. And I was sitting there, and I'm like, who has this job? Like, where else in the world does someone sit in a LAN center on a university campus and is able to kind of make waves in collegiate esports and do what they love and just be surrounded by friends? And I realized that this is honestly a dream career for a lot of gamers, and I made it, so I was happy about that. And I'm honestly very comfortable with where I am and just want to make things better for everyone else that follows.
So I'm pretty lucky because we're building a consumer brand. So for us, I just need to go on Twitter or go on Reddit or go in a forum and then kind of look up what the fans are saying or about our products. And people say, oh my God, I love your products. You guys are the most amazing. It's NZXT for life. And honestly, that makes everything worth it. So that's actually what drives me. You know, the guy down here says, you know, he's a lifelong NZXT fan. So like, this is the type of stuff that keeps me going. And that, like, that's really all I need. Yeah.
Are you out of battery?
It's not really out. Anyway, this is the end of my part. But there's a Q&A where you folks have asked the questions. But before we do that, half time, 38, 28, clearly you know who has the 38, right?
Yeah.
So right. That we would say, yes, please, folks.
I'm going to walk around with the mic, so it's
Is it possible to do two quick ones?
Yeah.
Okay, first one, for the commentators, does the word PewDiePie mean anything to you?
Yeah.
Sorry, what?
Sure.
Cutie pie or
PewDiePie?
PewDiePie.
PewDiePie.
I have my mouth wide shut.
I haven't kept up too much with the controversy over him and what was going on. I don't know what he said or anything like that. But yeah, no, PewDiePie is interesting because for myself, when I look at those things, I think about when I was a YouTuber and what people really, really enjoyed. And I think he kind of found a formulaic answer to a lot of things where he started off doing scary games and people loved watching him get scared. And they just started doing all this other high energy content and kind of set a bar for a lot of content creators. So I respect him in the regard of he kind of found what YouTube's target audience was and he like took off with that. Like the guy does an amazing job, but I don't know what's happened with him recently.
Okay, no problem. I'm not exactly like a huge fan of him specifically. He just has the name and, you know, he had a big target. My other question is, business-wise, a lot of business owners take a lot of loans and they take a lot of losses. And sometimes it's like third time's a charm. I'm just wondering, you guys as company owners, have you been through that? And, you know, how many losses or whatever has it taken? How many loans have you gone through? Or did you get it right the first time?
Don't use credit cards. That's all I'm going to say about that. Yeah, a lot. Absolutely. I've dug myself out of debts so many times, especially in the beginning. Yeah, it's just painful. And, you know, I would encourage, I mean, the world was different when I started out. I was on my own. I didn't have the background, didn't have mentors. That's not to say that they weren't out there, but today there's an ecosystem, especially here, that's developing, right? And between the Cove and other and UCI and other things that are going on. So there's a tremendous amount of knowledge, and I think you know, if I were me back then and I were starting out something now, I'd go learn as much as I can from other people quickly before just starting to spend money. It was never frivolous. But you end up paying the business before you pay yourself as you're learning. And I wouldn't recommend it. I mean, honestly, I would not recommend it. I'd figure out how to start a business properly. Because when I started my first business, it wasn't properly started. So there was a lot of struggle there. Yeah. I mean, it eventually became successful in its own right. But man, was there a lot of pain and fear. Yeah.
So I didn't necessarily have to take a lot of loan, but in the early days, we gave up most of the value, so our distributors and our customers made more money than we did, even though we designed the products, we marketed the products, we branded the products. But that's what happens when you're starting out, right? You need other people's help. So you learn to live with very little, right? And you know, and nowadays I see startups with these amazing offices, and that's kind of the end result. That's not kind of where you begin. And I was that's kind of weird to me because that's not how we did it. So. Yeah, I think it's. I actually also suggest not taking a loan because that could put on extra pressure that you might not want, you know. And friends and family, I think, is okay. Parents, you know, I think they won't ask for it back. So.
Did you guys keep up with the MLG? No, it was in Atlanta.
MLG Atlanta.
Yeah.
What about it? For what?
I don't know.
Oh. I actually don't know. I don't know. I apologize.
How do you guys hold your controllers? Like, what's your style?
That's a very personal question.
So if it's a GameCube controller and I'm playing Super Smash Brothers, I actually have a claw grip because you need to be able to hit the side buttons and be able to like hit the Y and the X. So you hold it like this, and this finger is actually hitting buttons at the top. So it's you kind of mangle yourself to play GameCube and play Melee. But normally I just hold it like a regular controller would.
Yeah, I don't really play console games.
I've got a question. It's kind of a follow-up to the last one, but. Particularly for Kieran and Johnny, a lot of students have passions and they find their passion, and maybe their passion is gaming. Maybe their passion is exactly what they're studying in the classroom. Folks around here in the room have passions and wondering how did you turn your passion into a business and into a career, you know, for Aiden and Kathy and for Dean Marios as well? When did you know that you had the idea that was going to do that for you? You knew that you had a crazy idea that you're going to turn into a profitable business or a profitable and fulfilling career where you actually took what you had as a student and translated that into the rest of your life.
I started leveraging it in the classroom, but I had no idea whether it was going to be profitable or not. It was more like, I'm just going to get this done and try it. Everybody else was going off and doing programming, and they were going to get high salaries, and the rest were going off to Arthur Anderson to be consultants. And I didn't like either one of those tracks because I saw what was happening in the with the internet and the web specifically. And so I ended up talking to one of my TAs, and they got me hooked up with a local company. I designed their website, then I designed another website, then I went out there and started knocking on doors and literally just cold calling companies, getting my first clients, and that's how it began. I will credit, there is an individual that I worked with, I did a job for, and I watched him. He's still a very good friend of mine, a mentor, who during my brief stint with him as a programmer designer, he turned around two companies in a two-year period, and I watched how he was as an entrepreneur. So I had that great experience to watch this guy in action, and I thought, oh, I could do that. I was completely wrong. Took a lot longer, and it was much more difficult, but that was kind of inspirational.
So before I started NZXT, I had already been doing a lot of website consulting. I was doing logo design. Flash was really big at the time. That was before Adobe acquired Macromedia, but I was doing Flash websites for people, and some of my clients just happened to be hardware companies in that space. So I started to do like design consulting for them, even though I wasn't like a trained industrial designer, and like some of my designs were proving to be quite successful in the market. So I was like, you know, maybe I can turn this into my own thing. So kind of that's kind of how that got in, how I got started. I was like testing my ideas with other brands, you know, so.
Yeah, I guess just in terms of running events, it's like when you make an event, so I guess as a club, first of all, you have meetings, right? So hopefully your club members are showing up to your meetings. And that kind of gave us the first push that, hey, people are coming out and talking and hanging out and doing fun things together. So maybe we can make this bigger and bigger. And eventually we started planning for things that were 1,000 people scale. And when people actually showed up, we said, hey, this is working. And for some reason, companies are giving us money to do this. So let's just keep doing it. So it's honestly, you just think of an idea that you think might work and you try it. And if it works out, then you keep going. And at some point, maybe you try too much and it fails. And then, you know, you bring it back a little bit. But that's just kind of how we did it.
The moment I realized that it would be profitable is probably like in the last year, even though I'd been hired professionally for 2 years, because it's still kind of like a shock to the system that I talk about video games for a living. Like it seems utterly ridiculous that people would want to listen to somebody talk about video games. So like Kathy was saying earlier, you do it for free for a very long time. I did it for free for about a year and a half, almost 2 years out of my dorm here in UCI where I got started. And then somebody's like, oh, I'll pay you $200 to cast on the weekend. I was like, $200? Are you kidding me? Like, that was awesome. So I made my first $200, and it was just like, oh, my God, this is really cool. But I didn't think it would ever be something where you're making a salary that could sustain, like, an apartment or anything like that, that you'd probably have to work a day job to actually be able to fuel your passion. So I kept doing my passion all the time, and then eventually I started YouTube, and YouTube was like, oh, you're getting paid like a little bit every month. So I was like, oh, I can, you know, do weekend tournaments, do YouTube, combine the money, maybe I'll have enough to like survive. So that's when I was like, you know what, I'm going all in. That's when I actually took a step back from UCI, delayed for a year, and put it on like hiatus for a bit, and then said, okay, we're going all in, we're gonna see what we can make of this. If it doesn't happen, I go back in a year. And then I ended up applying to Riot, they hired me, and then I was like, They put a number in my face, and I was like, yeah, no, that sounds really good. I don't have a bachelor's, but that sounds really good for somebody who doesn't have that. And so I took that, and I still didn't consider that like profitable. I was like, maybe someday I'll move on to a job that makes more money than that. And then as time has gone on, people have been realizing that commentators should get paid more and more and more. And so now I would say it's definitely very profitable to be an esports commentator, but you have to be very competitive and you have to be very good at what you do and spend a lot of your life doing it. So it's now profitable. And I would also say, like, this is another lesson, is know what you're worth, because you will undersell yourself for so long, especially when you are passionate about something, because you think, oh, they're paying me to talk about video games, I would do that for free. A lot of us sit up here and go, you know, I do that for free because it's something that I love doing. But you do have to get paid for it at the end of the day, and your skills do become desirable at a certain point, to the point that you should be making a decent amount of money for it. So the passion comes first, and then money comes after. And I think about, just final point here, back when I was in community college, I have my AA in theater and Shakespearean literature. And my theater teacher was like, you know, if you're doing it to be rich, if you're, you're an actor to be rich, you're doing it wrong, because you're always going to be disappointed. But if you're doing it because you love it, you're always going to be happy, and hey, you might get rich. So the passion has to come first.
This is going to be our last question.
My question's for Zyrene. I was wondering, what do you think of the collegiate players to professional players? Because, you know, I just lost my teammate Youngbin to Team Liquid, so I was wondering, like, do you approve of players getting, like, sort of poached from their degree right now, their degree, and how do you feel about, since you interact with so many players, like, do they wish they went to college first, or do they wish, like, they're fine with just going into pro without going to college?
So there's kind of a, like, I'll still say, like, we're less than a decade old in terms of the esports scene for League of Legends in particular. For StarCraft and Brood War, it's much older than that, but that's a different story. For League of Legends in my company, we do wish that, you know, people do what they want to do and what they're passionate about, whether that is go to school, complete your degree. And, you know, there have been people from, like, University of British Columbia who decided that, you know, they could go pro. DJJ could have gone pro. He won the UBC, or won ULOL twice, and was, like, top four all three times that he had actually attended. So he had a lot of scholarship money, and he said, no, I don't want to go pro, I want to continue. And that's kind of like what the collegiate path is for, is for people who don't necessarily want to become professional players immediately or in the immediate future or at all, so that they can go through college, get their education. But I do know that Team Liquid said that they are going to pay for Youngbin's education when he does come back. So him actually leaving college to go play for that team, they realize that he's making a sacrifice of withdrawing from all of his classes here at UCI, that when he goes back, they'll actually pay for it. So that may be something that we start adopting in the future as Riot, and give people a, you know, after professional player path. That's nothing guaranteed, but there are solutions that are being looked at to encourage people, you know, to maybe become a pro player and then maybe go back to college afterwards if that's not working out for them, or something along those lines. Thank you. I hope that answers your question. Yeah.
We are actually going to take one more question. So, all right, I saw your hand first.
Where were these hands before?
Yeah, so mine's a little weird. With the current situation of the world, having a lot of asylum seekers and immigrants coming into different worlds, do you think introducing video games to third world countries and second world emerging countries could be a financial business experience for companies that are looking for more of an audience for gaming?
I'll jump in while you look confused for a second.
I was just gonna say, like, that sounds like a sub-market to a sub-market.
Well, it's interesting, because gaming, so we're dealing with a slightly different faction of gaming, you know, in virtual reality, right? So what virtual reality has demonstrated in the non-gaming sense is an ability to communicate and build empathy. And being able to understand somebody else's point of view and put yourself in someone else's shoes. At Immersive, what we're doing is actually building full CGI worlds, living worlds. And so we're capable of putting you anywhere in any sort of situation. And so I think in that regard, it can make the world much smaller. A new release that we're gonna be coming out with would be multiplayer within this environment, allowing people to connect. And right now we're not talking about human avatars, we're talking about sort of cartoony avatars. But the effect is remarkable when you're standing in front of someone and all you can see is maybe a pair of cartoon eyes and some hands, and that's it. You still get a sense of presence. And what's interesting about that is, whereas on the internet and with a lot of multiplayer games where you're behind a 2D screen, you're kind of screaming at each other, shooting each other, whatever. VR has a tendency to personalize things in a way where people are more reticent to be insulting. They feel more of a presence. So it's kind of an interesting side effect, at least in our side of the industry, that we're witnessing already. Yeah, so it may be the humanizing of that distance and that gaming in a sense, because that other avatar could punch you out, you know?
So what was the question again, exactly? I just wanted to make sure that I'm getting it right.
The question is about if there's actually a market for like a third world and second world emergent, which means like the countries are like not first world, like America or like Korea or something like that, but not third world as well,
yeah.
Such as Italy or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, we have servers in like Turkey, in Latin America, in you know, Brazil, and then all these other places. Like, we are definitely opening in as many places as we can, trying to give people access to our game. When I said it's kind of like a submarket to a submarket, if you're talking about like actual third world countries, first people have to buy a computer, internet connection, then they have to actually get the video game, and we have to have a presence there as well, which then financially I don't think would actually be a very good thing. It's kind of like for like a virtual reality, they had this thing, what was it called? It was the Omni or something where you could run around? Yeah, that's a submarket to a submarket because not everybody's going for virtual reality, and if they are, then you have to give them that product too.
And that's why you have arcades popping up in VR, which is, you know, that's, yeah.
Yeah, so financially, I don't think it would be.
Thank you to our speakers. Can we have a round of applause to our speakers and for our moderator?